Good evening. My name is Dr. Nina Ahmad. I will be your moderator for this series on COVID-19 by the American Academy of Family Physicians. We will be hosting this series on Friday nights at 7 p.m. Central Standard Time. Each week, we will have a brief status update and a guest speaker. You can ask questions of our speakers before and after each session through the Member Exchange message board. You can also ask questions through the chat feature. Speakers will try their best to answer as many questions as they can, and some questions may be answered in future sessions. These sessions are recorded live, so you can always refer back to them. And they're being put together based on your feedback, so feel free to comment. This session is approved for 1 AAFP prescribed credits. It's an enduring credit, so you can always go back to it. It's also prescribed for 2 credits for T2P. And the speakers today have nothing to disclose. Here are the learning objectives for today. So first, I'll go over a quick situation summary and a brief background. And then our guest speaker, Dr. Gregory Botz, a professor of anesthesiology and critical care, will be speaking. We'll then do question and answers and then T2P reflection. So here's a graph. It's a snapshot of what's going on in the different countries, looking at the total confirmed COVID-19 cases. And you can see in red, the United States, the projection. And then in blue, in Italy, and green, China. Here, you can see the distribution of cases in the United States and the total number of cases as of yesterday, 865,585. And 48,816 deaths. So first I'll go through a few basics before we go over some questions about treatment that have been lingering and the data that surrounding them. For coronaviruses that infect humans, there are low pathogenic coronaviruses or COVIDs and high pathogenic COVIDs. For the low pathogenic COVIDs, they are usually lead to asymptomatic or mild flu-like syndromes. And they sometimes are associated with severe acute respiratory illnesses in some patients, but they've never been associated with major epidemics regionally or globally. They're typically seasonal, and there's different estimates about how many upper respiratory tract infections occur in adults, anywhere from 5 to 20%. The ones that are highlighted in the news periodically are the high pathogenic COVIDs, such as SARS-CoV-1, which occurred in 2003, MERS-CoV, the Middle Eastern Respiratory Syndrome, in 2012, and now SARS-CoV-2. So it's suspected that the origin is within bats. In China, there were over 500 COVIDs identified, an unknown bat COVID diversity of over 5,000. For MERS, it's suspected that the intermediate host was the camel. For SARS-CoV, the civet cat. And then for SARS-CoV-2, possibly the pangolin, there's still some investigation going on. When you look at the three, you can see for cases, SARS had 8,096 and MERS had 2,494 cases. The case fatality rate was 9.6% for SARS and MERS 34%, and we're still determining the case fatality rate for COVID-19. We know for SARS that the transmission suddenly stopped after about a year. And for MERS, they periodically have some spread. People have tried to speculate why SARS transmission suddenly stopped compared to COVID-19. And what the speculation has brought about is some people think that the reason why SARS was able to stop abruptly was that we knew where the reservoir was, that the outbreaks predominantly occurred in healthcare settings, so we could actually target those healthcare settings and make interventions, while right now COVID-19 is community spread, and that there was minimal asymptomatic spread for SARS. And for COVID-19, we believe asymptomatic and mild illnesses are occurring. So looking at the virus, well, the S protein, I'm sure many people have heard about. It's a structural protein needed to enter the cell, and it attaches to the ACE2 receptor. is thought to have mutated in somewhere around November 2019, which resulted in animal-to-human transmission. So why is it important? It's important because high blood pressure medications has been in the news quite a bit, and there's been confusion on what to do for ACE inhibitors and ARBs. An editorial came out recently that talked about where this came from. There are some in vitro studies talking about ACE inhibitors and ARBs increasing expression of ACE2, the enzyme. And it was speculated that possibly drugs that increased ACE2 might be causing higher risk for severe SARS-CoV-2 infection. And it was actually recommended possibly using calcium channel blockers instead. There are a number of commentaries that came out after that talking about not withdrawing these medications. In the editorial, they went through and made 5 points that there was no sound evidence from clinical studies that replacing ACE inhibitors and ARBs with other antihypertensives was associated with beneficial effects, that other studies carried out for SARS-CoV actually showed a protective effect. They also pointed out switching antihypertensive drugs in a frail population might actually increase negative outcomes, and that calcium channel blockers are antihypertensives that aren't approved for all the same things that ACE inhibitors and ARBs are. They also pointed out that none of the drug regulatory agencies worldwide recommended switching, and that the Italian drug agency actually issued a warning against doing so. Shortly around the same time as this editorial came out, there was also a retrospective multi-center study that was conducted, and they had 1,128 adults who had hypertension and diagnosed with COVID-19. They looked at all-cause mortality for inpatients using ACE inhibitors and ARBs. In the ACE inhibitor ARB group, there was 188 individuals and 940 non-ACE inhibitor ARBs individuals. The ages and the proportions for men compared to females were pretty much equivalent in the two groups. And they found there was a lower risk of all-cause mortality compared with ACE inhibitor ARB non-users. And that even though we needed additional information and had to look at potential confounders, that it was unlikely that inpatient use of ACE inhibitor and ARBs was associated with an increased mortality risk. The other question that's come up about treatment is ibuprofen versus acetaminophen. And in this article, they actually talked about where this came from. It started with a tweet talking about 4 cases of young patients who had no other underlying conditions and ended up having severe outcomes. And the only thing they could find was that they had NSAIDs in early stages of their symptoms. Many organizations and individuals came forward saying it might be possible. But after this, WHO actually came out with a scientific brief recently, and they did a rapid systematic review and reviewed 73 studies. And in those studies, a number of findings were found. Of significance, they said that most studies report no severe adverse events occurred, or only mild or moderate adverse events were observed, and no evidence regarding the effects of NSAIDs use on acute healthcare utilization, explicit quality of life measures, or long-term survival. They did talk about some of the limitations of the review, which you can see with the link below. So now I'd like to introduce our guest speaker, Dr. Botz. I am really happy that he's here today. As we move forward towards a new normal by slowly reopening, I think it'll be helpful to hear what he has to say, because he speaks to some of his experience with surge capacity, and some of us may be called upon for surge capacity in the future. So I'd like to introduce Dr. Gregory Botz, who is board certified in anesthesiology and critical care medicine. He has served as the University of Texas Chancellor's Health Fellow in Quality of Care and Patient Safety, and chair of the Fundamental Critical Care Support Program for the Society of Critical Care Medicine. Currently, he is a member of the UT System Academy of Health Science Education and is the medical director of the MD Anderson Cancer Center Simulation Center. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for the introduction, and I'm happy to be here this evening to speak to you about ventilator management and the COVID-19 crisis. First, I want to make sure that I disclose I have no conflict of interests or financial relationships, and the views and opinions that I'm going to express tonight are my own. They're not necessarily the views of my employer. My objectives tonight are to describe the tiered approach to critical care in disasters, talk about how you can access the freely available SECM Fundamentals Education resources, discuss the basic principles of mechanical ventilation, to review with you what you might need to know and do if you are called upon to participate in the care of some of these patients who require mechanical ventilation, and then I'd like to share some additional resources. But first, I want to describe the tiered approach to critical care. The typical operations in the ICU is using an intensivist-led critical care team with a variety of different providers that bring their best to the care of these critically ill patients who are often the sickest patients in the hospital. But as you can imagine now, in the time of our current pandemic, many of you have seen this figure in one way or another. We are at risk for being overwhelmed with the number of patients with the COVID-19 viral disease. And the concern is that our healthcare system will be overwhelmed beyond its capacity, and that excess capacity will add to the potential for poor outcomes for our patients. Now, I'm in contact with a number of my colleagues who practice critical care, both in the United States and in the world, and we have lots of examples of things that happened in Italy, in New York, in Detroit, and New Orleans that speak to the excess capacity and the difficulty in managing these patients when they were overwhelmed with a large number of patients all at once. So the Society of Critical Care Medicine for a number of years has had a fundamental disaster management course, which describes how the healthcare system can flex to manage the healthcare needs when there is a surge. And this is an example of a tiered staffing strategy for a pandemic, where the usual model for the delivery of healthcare is augmented by other non-ICU providers who can help take care of the large number of patients that overwhelm our system. And they can act as force multipliers for us to care for this large number of patients. And it improves not only our critical care reach, but our span of control over these particularly critically ill patients. One of the reasons why I'm speaking to you tonight is because I'm worried that we're going to need your help. You're going to be very important to us in managing these patients if we hit a surge in any particular community. We know we've had surges in New York and Detroit and many other cities like New Orleans, but we're all hoping that we are not going to be in a situation in our own communities where we're overwhelmed. I'd like to discuss a few differences in the COVID-19 disease than what we may see in other kinds of viral illnesses or pandemics. In the study of the early outbreak in China, they studied about 46,000 patients to look for their symptom complex. And they found that about 80% of the patients had mild or moderate flu symptoms but didn't require hospitalization, and none of those patients died. But those patients that had some respiratory symptoms requiring hospitalization, they were about 15% of the overall population. And they were easily managed with supplemental oxygen and the general care that we have for people with an inflammatory disease process. None of those patients died either. It was the 5% or so of patients that went on to develop acute respiratory failure, predominantly acute hypoxemic respiratory failure, that ended up in the ICU, and even with multiple organ system dysfunction, a lot like advanced septic shock. And in the Chinese experience, about half of those patients died. Now, what's peculiar about this particular viral syndrome is the predominance of a ground glass pneumonia. It's not the usual community lobar pneumonia that we see with people with worsening acute respiratory failure. But in fact, there's a patchy ground glass pneumonia that affects very large portions of the lung parenchyma and leads to a profound hypoxemia. In fact, my colleagues in the emergency departments have described these patients that come in with respiratory complaints as being the happy hypoxics. They have flu symptoms, but they aren't profoundly in distress. But when they look at their oxygen saturation, many of these patients have an oxygen saturation in the high 70s or low to mid 80s, despite not looking that sick. And that is profoundly scary for us to see patients that hypoxemic. So in order to protect our healthcare providers, we've done things to try to avoid aerosol generating procedures or AGPs. So for instance, we don't do nebulized breathing treatments for fear that we'll aerosolize the virus into the environment. We don't use bag valve mask ventilation before intubation for the same reason. And we certainly have avoided using non-invasive ventilation like BiPAP or CPAP, where there's a mask that could leak and aerosolize into the environment around it. There's been some discussion about the use of high flow nasal cannula. There's concern about the aerosol generating properties of the use of that modality, but we found that it's been very helpful in people with progressive respiratory failure, and the surviving sepsis guidelines even particularly speak about the effectiveness of using high flow nasal cannula to avoid intubation. Now, as you can imagine, when this virus started spreading across the globe, there was a significant amount of fear about what this was actually going to look like and how we were going to manage it. And so we do what we do in any sort of disaster like this, is we find out what others have done and we try to replicate that as the best idea. And early on in this epidemic or this outbreak, we found that because of the profound hypoxemia, people were being intubated very early and placed on mechanical ventilation. And there was a certain number of people that ended up in the ICU that had what looked like an acute respiratory distress syndrome, or ARDS. Now, the difference may be that usually in ARDS, we see a low lung compliance or stiff lungs that alters the way that we typically ventilate. But in many of these patients, we see a high lung compliance. Their lungs aren't as stiff, but they still have profound hypoxemia. And maybe we need to consider ventilating their lungs in a different way. Others have compared the ARDS to the high altitude pulmonary edema phenomenon that we see at times in people who are at altitude. And the ground glass opacifications do look a lot like what you might see in high altitude pulmonary edema. But I want to just share with everybody that it's not HAPE. This is not high altitude pulmonary edema. High altitude pulmonary edema is a pressure phenomenon in the lungs, whereas this is an inflammatory response from the viral infection itself. And please don't consider using the medications that are typically used for HAPE in these patients, because they would be counterproductive. And next, I'd like to take you, walk you through the access to the Society of Critical Care Medicine Fundamentals Education resources. It can be a little bit confusing to get through the different layers to get to the material of interest. And I want to reiterate that all of this material is free for you to use. There's no firewall. It's available for anybody who needs information about the management of critical illness for these patients. The Society of Critical Care Medicine for more than 20 years has had an educational program called the Fundamentals Courses, or the Fundamentals Program. In addition to the inward-looking education material for intensive care providers that are part and parcel to the education mission of the Society, they also have an outward-looking education program called Fundamentals, which is really critical care for the non-intensive care provider. We realize that not everybody can get a patient to an ICU quickly. There may be either bed availability issues or distance availability issues if you don't have an ICU in your institution. So these courses focus on the management of critical illness until an ICU transfer can be accomplished. Now, there's an adult and pediatric fundamentals course, and there's a fundamental disaster management course that have been around for many years. There's also a fundamental critical care support course for obstetrics and tropical diseases, and now a fundamental critical care support for resource-limited environments. In the fundamental disaster management course, there's a lot of work that speaks to the distributed ICU care model in disaster and surge conditions. Now, these courses are available to take online through the Society's web portal, or you can take an in-person course with an instructor-led didactic and skills session experience. And there's also the ability to do a hybrid course where you can take the didactic material online and then meet in person to do the skill stations and practice with the critical care technologies with an instructor. Now, to get to the material from the Society of Critical Care Medicine, this is the web address or the link. It's www.seccm.org/disaster. When you follow that link, you'll land on this landing page, which you can see has a, on the left-hand side, a lot of links to various information that's really helpful for this particular event that's going on now. On the right-hand side, if we scroll down the page, you can see that there's a header called Education and Resources. And there's three bulleted points. The middle bulleted point is how you get to the course for non-ICU clinicians. So if you click this link, it will take you then to this particular landing page, which gives you an opportunity to enter your contact information so that you can be contacted when new or updated information is added to this resource. Having done that, you can click on the Here link to proceed to the next page. This is the portal that gets you into the SECM Education Center with all of the material that's available. This is the page it takes you to. I'm just gonna show you some screenshots as we scroll down. First, there's a self-assessment quiz you can take that might help you to check your knowledge of the various topics to know where to drill down for additional information. Scrolling down, there's particular topics taken from the fundamentals courses like recognition and assessment of the critically or the seriously ill patient, airway management, critical care for the elderly, diagnosis and management of acute respiratory failure. And then there's two lectures here with an overview video on top that talks in more detail than I'm going to be able to tonight in this talk about mechanical ventilation. If you go down farther, there's some materials from the fundamental disaster management course, which speaks to disaster preparedness and response. And some of that also speaks directly to the tiered approach to distributed ICU care when the system is at capacity or overwhelmed. Next, I'd like to talk to the meat of this talk, which is the basic principles of mechanical ventilation. And I realize that many of you may have had an opportunity to manage mechanical ventilation during your training, but haven't done that at all during your career. And it's rather intimidating to think about having to do this in a disaster mode. And I want to just give you some basic information that might help you both understand mechanical ventilation and have an idea of where to go to get more information. Now, believe me, we aren't going to put you in a tiered system and say, ready, go, just go manage a ventilator. There is going to be support there to help take care of these patients. It's just going to be in a distributed model. So this is my world. This is my ICU at MD Anderson. This picture was taken many years ago before HIPAA. I know there's a patient in there because I can see his hand and I remember this case. The ICU can be a very, very intimidating place because these patients are incredibly sick and they're requiring a lot of life support measures in order to manage their organ system function. And we use a lot of technology to both monitor and manage these patients while we're trying to allow them time to recover from their critical illness. Now, this patient actually had a very large surgical procedure for an advanced cancer, and he was requiring quite a bit of life support over the course of a number of days. Now, he got out of the ICU and came back, walked in and shook our hands and thanked us for the care that we provided. And he gave me permission to use this picture in my educational presentations. Just to the right of his bed, you can see a screen. That's the mechanical ventilator that we were using at the time to provide respiratory support to a patient who couldn't manage the respiratory needs on his own. Again, these principles are better described in detail in these two lectures on the FCCS SECM site for materials. I know mechanical ventilators are incredibly intimidating. I think that I share with you the fear of making a mistake and harming someone by messing with a ventilator that you really don't have a lot of experience and comfort in managing. I want to dispel some of that tonight by just describing what it is and how it works. And you can see the picture on the right-hand side is just a picture of a ventilator simulator that's available. I'll talk about a little bit later. On the left-hand side, you see some variables that are displayed for what the ventilator is actually able to achieve in tidal volume rate, etc. To the right of that, you see some waveforms that help to describe how the ventilator is functioning and what the patient's interaction might be. On the bottom, you see some circles that are really the variables that we set to try to deliver mechanical ventilation. And there are lots of different ventilators available. There's lots of news about the latest and greatest modes of ventilation that can be used to manage different disease processes. But I can assure you that all of the commercially available ventilators that we use in the ICU can all do the basic traditional modes of ventilation that have been around for 20 years or more. Now, the manufacturers may use different labels to describe that kind of ventilation, but in essence, the settings and the way that we deliver the ventilation is all the same. When we talk about using a mechanical ventilator, we decide about how the ventilator is going to deliver a breath, whether it's a pressure preset breath or a volume preset breath. A pressure preset breath is one where the ventilator senses or needs to give a breath, and it increases the pressure in the circuit, and the tidal volume flows along that pressure gradient into the patient's lungs. Now, depending on the compliance of the lungs, the tidal volume that's actually delivered may be quite variable. Whereas in a volume preset mode, when a breath is either needed or desired by the patient, the ventilator tries to deliver a set volume, and the pressure that's generated is dependent upon the compliance of the patient's lungs. We think the safest mode of ventilation to teach to people who don't manage ventilators very often is to use a volume preset mode, because generating an acceptable and necessary tidal volume is probably the most important thing to teach someone who doesn't do this very often. The two volume preset modes that are most commonly used are assist control and synchronized intermittent mandatory ventilation, or SIMV. Now, some of you may have heard of PRVC, or pressure regulated volume control. That's a hybrid mode that uses the best of pressure preset and volume preset using the computer built into the ventilator to try to match in real time the patient's needs on a breath-to-breath basis. Now, pressure support ventilation is a mode that helps to support spontaneous ventilation. When patients take an inspiratory effort, pressure support helps to reduce the resistance, both from airways resistance and the resistance from the endotracheal tube and circuit itself. Now, when I teach mechanical ventilation, I talk about the big five. Those are the five settings that you need to set in order to deliver a volume preset mode of ventilation. Now, there are more settings and more variables that need to be considered, but the default values for those variables are usually acceptable for a patient's initial ventilation when you pick the big five. The big five are FiO2, or oxygen concentration, the tidal volume, or volume that you want to deliver with each breath, the respiratory rate, how many breaths per minute, and then positive end expiratory pressure, or PEEP. That's some back pressure that's left in the circuit at the end of expiration to try to keep lung segments open. And the pressure support augments spontaneous breaths if the patient's allowed to breathe spontaneously on the mode. Now, an important consideration is that the tidal volume times the rate is equal to the minute ventilation, which is liters per minute. And we try to initially target the patient's previous minute ventilation when we put them on mechanical ventilation, because that's what they were requiring before. It's not wrong to be far off from that number. It just means you'll have to make a number of changes to try to match what their needs are. So I try to target the minute ventilation that they're on just before we intubate them, and then make adjustments from there, because you're usually closer to what the patient's real needs will be. Now, there are some variables that you need to understand when we describe how the ventilator delivers a breath. So on the y-axis is volume and the x-axis is time. The trigger is how the ventilator will generate a breath. It's how it knows to start inhalation. The flow pattern is how the air is actually pushed into the lungs. That can be a square wave or a sine wave, an ascending or descending pattern. That's not important. Whatever the default flow pattern is on the ventilator is perfectly fine for the type of ventilation that we're initiating. Now, the limit is a safety feature that helps us not to overpressurize the lung when we're delivering a volume breath. So the limit will stop you from overpressurizing the lung. And then the cycle is how the ventilator knows to stop inhalation and switch to passive exhalation. So we can describe a breath delivered by a volume cycled ventilator as being a pressure triggered, pressure limited, and volume cycled breath, for example. Now, when we use mechanical ventilation, we're really trying to augment gas exchange that the patient can't do on their own. And the determinants of gas exchange that we're really interested in are oxygenation and ventilation. The main determinant of oxygenation on mechanical ventilation is the FiO2, or the concentration of oxygen, and the mean airway pressure, which is affected by these variables that we're going to talk about in just a minute. And ventilation is how we eliminate carbon dioxide from the lungs. And ventilation is inversely related to the minute ventilation. So as minute ventilation goes up, PaCO2 goes down and vice versa. And we can manipulate the respiratory rate and tidal volume to affect the minute ventilation that we want in order to have the right ventilation for a patient on mechanical ventilation. These are some airway pressure tracings that we can use to see how the ventilator and the patient are working together. On the left-hand side, you see the y-axis is pressure and the x-axis is time. By convention, the x-axis is a zero point, and a deflection above the line is positive pressure, and a deflection below the line is negative pressure. This is an example of spontaneous breathing. Now, you'll have to excuse me, this graph is not quite correct because I'm really poor at drawing pictures on PowerPoint. We know that expiration is a passive process, so we don't usually go above the zero line on exhalation. So we should really just shift that line down just a little bit. But you can see on the right-hand side, this is an example of adding in pressure to the circuit during respiration. In spontaneously breathing people, we call that CPAP. And in mechanically ventilated patients, we call that PEEP, positive end expiratory pressure. We're just increasing the baseline around which the patient breathes. You can see inspiration and expiration, and that helps to keep lung segments open so that gas exchange can be favored. We don't want the lung segments to open and collapse with each breath. Now, the first mode of ventilation that we consider in a volume preset mode is assist control. And this is the tracing that we see with assist control. You can see an inspiratory part of the waveform and an expiratory part of the waveform. We come back down to the baseline where positive end expiratory pressure is. Now, we set a backup rate to give a certain number of breaths each minute. If the patient wants to take a breath in between there, you can see on the last waveform, there's a little dip below the baseline. And the ventilator sees that as an inspiratory effort, and it gives a full mechanical breath. In assist control, every inspiratory effort is met with a full mechanical breath. Pressure support ventilation is similar in that when the ventilator senses flow or pressure changes in the circuit, it increases the pressure in the circuit to whatever preset value we have to try to reduce the resistance to flow that's imparted by the endotracheal tube or perhaps the trachea itself. So you can see this square waveform from a pressure support ventilation. It supports spontaneous breathing. The other mode of ventilation that we use for volume preset is SIMV, or synchronized intermittent mandatory ventilation. Now, we can use that with or without pressure support. So on the top is without pressure support, and you can see in between the mandatory breaths that the ventilator has to deliver, the patient can take spontaneous breaths. The problem is the amount of work it takes to open the demand valve to get that breath is often more than the patient can really handle with their respiratory status. And so we add pressure support, as you see on the bottom tracing, so that when the patient takes a spontaneous breath, they get a pressure supported breath. So this is SIMV with pressure support. Now, this is a busy slide, but it's really the big five with numbers attached. How do we initiate mechanical ventilation if we're asked to do so? And I said we prefer that we use a volume preset mode in the initial mechanical ventilation. We start with 100% oxygen, or an FiO2 of 1. And once we're at a steady state, we can then think about decreasing the FiO2 in a stepwise fashion while maintaining an acceptable oxygen saturation of 92 to 94%. The initial tidal volume is based on the patient's ideal body weight. We teach 6 to 8 milliliters per kilogram as an initial setting. Now, this is where the difference between a compliant and a non-compliant lung is important. In a highly compliant lung, we traditionally target 8 to 10 milliliters per kilogram so that we get enough gas into the lungs to spread and distribute across those lung segments that have blood flow and get the best matching of ventilation and perfusion. But in lungs that are stiff with a bad pneumonia or with fibrosis, as we see in ARDS, the ARDS net data shows that ventilating with a lower tidal volume is actually protective for the lung that's not injured. So we pick 4 to 6 milliliters per kilogram in that circumstance. Next, we want to pick the respiratory rate to go along with the tidal volume in order to generate the appropriate minute ventilation. Now you can choose, say, 12 breaths per minute or 16 breaths per minute, which would be a normal respiratory rate. And that's not wrong to do that, but maybe you can target the minute ventilation that the patient had prior to intubation by taking the tidal volume based on the patient's weight and then adjusting the respiratory rate up or down to match that minute ventilation. Next, we add PEEP to try to support oxygenation. We start with 3 to 5 centimeters of PEEP and then titrate up or down as needed. Now, we try not to go above 10 centimeters water PEEP unless we have some help with a critical care consultant that might be able to help us understand what the consequences might be in using that in a particular patient. Finally, if we're using SIMV, we'll add in pressure support to support the spontaneous breaths, and we pick somewhere between 5 and 10. It's an arbitrary number. We won't know whether it's the right number until we see the patient breathe spontaneously and see what tidal volumes they're actually generating with that pressure support. Now, you will have, in a distributed model, a critical care consultant who can be available to help if there are any problems or questions as you are beginning the initiation of mechanical ventilation. And the respiratory therapist will be around as well to make adjustments and perhaps set the alarms at appropriate levels for these patients, but they're going to be in scarce numbers. And so they probably will just continue to round on patients who are undergoing mechanical ventilation, no matter where they are in that particular hospital. In talking to some of my colleagues in New York, one of the major academic medical centers at one point had all of their ICU beds occupied by COVID patients who were on mechanical ventilation. And they had to use 10 operating rooms with anesthesia machines that have mechanical ventilators on them. They had 3 patients per room, and they had 10 operating rooms filled with COVID patients during the peak of their admissions. So once we've picked the initial ventilator support, this is the triad that I recommend that you use to evaluate the efficacy of the settings that you have chosen. The first thing to do and always do is watch the patient. Look for chest rise and fall with tidal volume. Look for symmetry of chest movement and see how well the patient is synchronized with the settings that you have made. Now, once you're comfortable that that's okay, check the monitors. Make sure that there isn't any significant change in the vital signs that might signal a complication of mechanical ventilation, and we're going to talk a little bit about that in a few minutes. And finally, make some adjustments to the ventilator. Look at the volumes, the pressures, and the tracings that we've talked about and that we're going to talk about, and then after you're happy with those settings, then set alarms. And you may not be asked to set the alarms, but the default alarm should be acceptable at the initial phase, and the respiratory therapist will certainly come around and help set alarms that are appropriate for the patient at the time. And I tell our novice providers who take our FCCS courses, use this triad. Once you get through it, repeat it. Keep going through until you're comfortable that the patient is being adequately ventilated. And certainly if the patient has a change in their status, go back and repeat this to make sure that there isn't something amiss in one of these different categories. Now, we talked about some pressures that we monitor to see how well the ventilator is matching the patient's needs. Typically, we manage the inspiratory pressures, the peak inspiratory pressure, or P-peak, otherwise known as the peak inspiratory pressure, or PIP, and the inspiratory plateau pressure, or P-plat. Now, the peak inspiratory pressure is a measure of dynamic compliance. It's the airway pressure that's generated while air is moving. So the peak pressure that occurs in the circuit while air is moving into the patient's lungs is the peak inspiratory pressure. And when there's no air moving, when the airway pressure is measured, when there's no air moving in the circuit, that's static compliance or inspiratory plateau pressure. And that's a direct indicator of alveolar distension. You can see in this figure below, this is an example of a respiratory cycle looking at the pressures generated with the mechanical breath. The respiratory cycle is from the beginning of one breath until the initiation of the next breath. And that respiratory cycle is divided into inspiration and expiration. You can see at the top, there's a peak inspiratory pressure, which is the highest pressure that's measured in the circuit while air is moving. And then once the air is stopped and we're ready to exhale, it will settle at an inspiratory plateau pressure. And we want to make sure that we keep the plateau pressure at or below 30 centimeters of water so that the ventilator doesn't induce lung injury to those unaffected areas of the lung that are still participating in gas exchange. On the right side, you can see an actual tracing from one of our ventilators showing you the peak and the plateau pressures. So what are the adverse effects of having a high plateau pressure? Well, we want to avoid barotrauma and volutrauma. We don't want to overpressurize or overdistend the alveoli and cause an injury that's induced by the ventilator itself. And having excessive pressure or volume can lead to hemodynamic compromise, which is undesirable. Maneuvers that we can use to decrease the plateau pressure would be to either decrease the PEEP or tidal volume or both as appropriate to get the plateau pressure to an acceptable level. Another variable that we consider is the inspiratory-expiratory ratio, often called the IE ratio. And it's really looking at what percentage or what portion of the respiratory cycle do we spend in inspiration and what portion do we spend in expiration. And typically, since inspiration is an active process and expiration is a passive process, we have to give time for the breath to come out. And so typically an IDE ratio of 1:2 or 1:3 is necessary. In patients with bronchospasm or reactive airways disease, typically 1:3 to 1:4 would be more appropriate. And so we can manipulate the inspiratory and expiratory variables in order to achieve that. So the determinants of inspiratory time with volume ventilation are tidal volume and in the inspiratory flow rate, how fast we're pushing the gas in. And so we call inspiratory time as a shortcut. We call it I time. And you can see the tidal volume is directly related to I time. And inspiratory flow rate is conversely opposite of the rate. As you go up in the respiratory rate, you have less time for inspiration. So we may be able to manipulate the tidal volume and the rate, the minute ventilation itself, in order to achieve an acceptable IDE ratio. If we have inadequate expiratory time, we may have incomplete exhalation and breath stacking. We call that breath stacking auto-PEEP. And that's where the next breath starts before the last breath finished. And that can be detrimental because the lung volume will continue to slowly increase over time with subsequent breaths and lead to both volutrauma or barotrauma. How do we diagnose it? We look at the flow versus time tracing on the mechanical ventilator, and we look at the waveform themselves. So you can see here a figure that is the flow versus time tracing for mechanical ventilation. And I apologize, the white labels have shifted on this particular figure, but you can see just where the A in auto PEEP is on the tracing itself. You can see that there's a flattening of the expiratory limb before it gets back to the zero line where there's no flow. So the next breath happened before the flow out had ceased. And this is what we call auto PEEP. We're slowly increasing the amount of air in the lungs with subsequent breaths. That's not a good thing. So what are the consequences of auto PEEP? Well, the inspiratory pressures will continue to climb. Because we're increasing intrathoracic pressure, we may decrease venous return and make cardiac output suffer, so we can have hypotension. And certainly by over-distending the alveoli, we can make the ventilation and perfusion matching worse and have worsening oxygenation. Interventions that we consider to decrease auto-PEEP would be to decrease the respiratory rate. That way you give more time for inspiration and exhalation, or decrease the tidal volume so you don't have to put as much air in with each breath, or consequently decrease the I time or increase the gas flow rate so that breath goes in faster with each respiratory cycle. Now, we said there were some complications of mechanical ventilation that we need to think about when we do the triad after we initiate mechanical ventilation. And one of the ones that I'm most concerned about is tension pneumothorax. That can occur when you put someone on positive pressure ventilation, especially if there's a bit of excess pressure in one particular area of the lung or another. And we need to consider this in patients who have hemodynamic instability after the initiation of mechanical ventilation. They will have absent or asymmetric breath sounds. When you listen to the chest, they'll have tachycardia and tachypnea, and certainly a fall in oxygen saturation. Tension pneumothorax is a medical emergency. We can't wait for a chest film to see it. It's a clinical diagnosis, and usually we will decompress the side that's not moving or seems to be hyperexpanded by putting a large bore needle or catheter in the chest cavity to equalize the pressure, let some of the air out. We're not trying to take all of the air out, just equalize the pressure and the lung will expand. After that, we can put a small thoracostomy tube in to re-expand the pneumothorax. That's not a big deal. The life-saving maneuver is letting the pressure out. So here's a diagram about how to do it. Now, our surgical colleagues like to put chest tubes in on the side and the mid-axillary line. But for the purposes of an emergency needle decompression, the best place is in the anterior chest, in the second intercostal space, in the mid-clavicular line. That's the place where you're less likely to hit lung tissue or vascular tissue because it's being displaced away by the pressure of the tension pneumothorax. Typically, we use a 14-gauge or a 16-gauge angiocath and put it in over the rib into the pleural space and allow the air to escape. The other complication that we think about with mechanical ventilation is the effect of increased intrathoracic pressure with positive pressure, and that can lead to decreased venous return. Because of decreased venous return, we can have a fall in cardiac output. Now, typically, the patients who we intubate for respiratory failure have been working kind of hard to breathe before we intubate them, and they might be a bit volume depleted. And so we're ready to give a little bit of fluid to match the decrease in venous return when someone's placed on pressure. We have to be concerned, though, in COVID, because we don't want to give a lot of fluid and make those ground glass opacifications worse by leaking into the pulmonary parenchyma. So patients who are also catecholamine depleted because they've been working so hard to breathe, to oxygenate, once you relax them with taking over the work of breathing for them, they may be catecholamine depleted, and you need to be ready to watch for cardiopulmonary decline or cardiopulmonary arrest because they really don't have any catecholamine reserve left. And these patients we put on vasopressors or inotropes. Some shared additional resources for you. I wanted to show you this resource. This is from Open Pediatrics, which is a product of the Boston Children's Hospital. The web link is at the bottom of this picture. This is a really nice tutorial and simulator that you can practice with in making the big five choices and seeing the waveforms and seeing what sort of numbers you get back with the settings that you might make. Now, granted, this is a pediatric simulator, but you can set it for adult settings and it'll do the same thing. The tutorials are a little bit targeted to the pediatric population, but you can see at the bottom left, there are some adult considerations. I would say that if you're going to be called upon to either manage patients with mechanical ventilation or are willing to help in the distributed ICU model, it might be a good idea to practice with this simulator a little bit just to get familiar with how to make some changes in the mechanical ventilator settings. So in summary, we're in a bit of a pickle with COVID-19 because of the very significant risk for overwhelming our healthcare system. And we're going to need your help, perhaps, if we have a second or a third wave of COVID before we can gain either herd immunity or vaccination that helps to protect the number of patients that might be presenting to our hospitals all at one time. So I've tried to give to you some basic mechanical ventilation strategies, the safe ones that we can think about. And we recommend the volume preset mode of ventilation. Think about the big five settings that we've talked about. Try to target the minute ventilation that's appropriate for the patient based on where they were before they were intubated and placed on mechanical ventilation. And that's by manipulating the tidal volume and the rate appropriately. Follow the inspiratory pressures to guide and gauge how well the ventilator is matching the patient's needs and to make sure that there isn't a mismatch somewhere that's going to cause problems. And then look out for the adverse effects like the tension pneumothorax or decreased cardiac output that can happen when you place someone on positive pressure ventilation. My advice to you is practice, 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 because It's not easy to get up to speed on mechanical ventilation, but it's not an overwhelming thing if you stick to the basics. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Botz. This was really helpful and I think very valuable, not only for people who are working on it right now, but potentially in the future as we move forward. As we start looking at the questions in our live feed, I want people to reflect on how this might change their practice and what they do. I know for me, it's helpful to see the resources that we have available and the interactive resources and also this live enduring talk that you just did. And I see a lot of people are saying thank you and really appreciate it from California to Japan. Nori Yuki Umura says thank you, Akita, Japan. And then Rick Metterder from Facebook says, since high flow nasal cannula decrease work of breathing, what O2 sats are you okay with before going to intubation?
Fantastic question. The data is not set yet. We're learning as we go, but I think that most of the people are comfortable with an oxygen saturation somewhere around 92%. In ARDS with stiff lungs, we've been happy with 88 to 92% at times. I think the jury is still out in this patient population. I think the thing that frightens people most is that these patients become profoundly hypoxemic without really any clue that something else is changing. And so we want to have a little bit of a safety factor so that we don't fall onto the really steep part of the oxyhemoglobin dissociation curve and have profound desaturation. So say 90 to 92% would be acceptable.
Okay. And then Susan Hill from YouTube asks, what do we know now about prone ventilation and COVID? Also interested in general.
Fantastic question. You know, there's been a lot of work, especially by Gattinoni in Italy, about using prone ventilation in ARDS patients for many years. And he published an editorial that talked about how this might be very helpful in COVID-19 disease, but we need to be careful not to think that all of them have stiff lungs and need low tidal volume and high oxygen concentration to manage. There's some good evidence, and many centers are now doing prone positioning in patients on mechanical ventilation, and even asking patients who are not yet intubated, who may be on supplemental oxygen, either with a face mask or high flow nasal cannula, to turn over on their stomach for a certain number of hours. And I think the reason that that helps is because of the physiology of the lungs. You know, typically when we evolved, we were walking on all fours. And so the best ventilation perfusion matching was actually on the dorsal part of the lungs. There's better matching of blood flow and oxygenation there. So by turning over on your stomach, you get better matching in areas of lung that might be injured. So in fact, at some institutions, they're recommending that you turn your patients over onto their stomach for a number of hours while they're getting supplemental oxygen, even if they aren't mechanically ventilated. We're trying to avoid intubating everybody as we were early on in this outbreak, because the outcomes of people who are on mechanical ventilation are less than stellar for a variety of reasons.
I think that's really helpful. Thank you. And then Maria Claire from YouTube asked, do repeat ABGs play a role in managing mechanical ventilation?
I would say yes, they do, but I would temper that by saying that I get a baseline arterial blood gas about 20 to 30 minutes after I put someone on mechanical ventilation who is on a stable setting. If I'm making adjustments, they aren't going to reach an equilibrium right away. And so maybe 20 to 30 minutes later, I'll get a blood gas to gauge how well I think the mechanical ventilator settings are matching their needs and what that's doing with oxygenation and ventilation. But I don't routinely get blood gases every 2 hours or every 4 hours just as a matter of cause, because I think that we have good information based on physical exam and what the ventilator is telling us. And we may be oversampling in these patients. If they have a change, if you can't explain the change in physiology based on what you're seeing with the ventilator, certainly get an arterial blood gas. But getting them routinely especially in a circumstance where you have many, many patients on mechanical ventilators and lots of blood gases being drawn, you may be overwhelming the lab's ability to either do point of care or do laboratory-based arterial blood gas measurements. Do a baseline, do it when you make changes, and do it for cause.
Blaise Vitale from Facebook asks, what settings most commonly cause an iatrogenic pneumothorax? Using the monitor, are there ways to tell if one has occurred?
So using the monitor, the physiologic monitors, we see tachycardia and hypoxemia, and often we start to see the blood pressure drop as cardiac output drops. In a tension pneumothorax, the pleural cavity is under pressure and it pushes the heart and mediastinum away from it, which decreases both cardiac performance and blood return. High pressures, certainly, with a high peak and certainly a high plateau pressure over time can lead to a tension pneumothorax. It's predominantly a clinical diagnosis, looking at the patient, seeing that their chest is not rising symmetrically, maybe seeing hyperresonance if you palpate the side that's not moving. I tell our trainees, and I tell anybody who will listen to me, that if you suspect that there's a tension pneumothorax and your patient is becoming unstable, put a needle in and vent that side. Even if you're wrong, it's easy to manage. Not doing it is lethal. So seeing high pressures, typically we try to keep the positive pressure less than 30. If you get up into the range of peak inspiratory pressure of 40 and 50, the risk of pneumothorax goes up.
Thank you. So as members reflect on how they're going to change their practice or how this has helped in the feed, we can ask one more question and then the rest of the questions can be answered through the member message board. So the last question will be from Rick Metterer. What type of IV fluids are advised at hypotensive complications you described?
Crystalloids. Colloids play no role. And in this inflammatory response, the lung injury, the colloids will go, like albumin, will go out into the lung and make that that pressure gradient worse. So small aliquots, 250 cc's of lactated ringers or normal saline to see if that improves venous return and cardiac performance is the best way to go.
Great, thank you. And then I'm just going to grab one last question. I kind of lied because this question came up before on a previous session and wasn't answered on the live feed. So Pulvi Patel, since this has come up multiple times from Facebook, asks, thank you from Baton Rouge. Are you seeing a lot of benefit from Vapotherm, or are you finding most of these patients are eventually needing to be intubated?
So early on, we followed what everybody else was doing, which was early intubation. And I think what we're learning now, especially from our colleagues in New Orleans and in other places, is that they can manage patients with high flow nasal cannula like Vapotherm. That's a brand name for a high flow nasal cannula device. You can manage them maybe for 24 to 48 hours without having to intubate them. And there's been good success. Not everybody will, you know, avoid intubation, but we're not rushing to early intubation like we were initially based on the advice of people that went through the surge before us.
Thank you. So I do see from the feed a lot of people feel that this has been a really good refresher for them and a great resource, and everybody's thanking you for your time.
My pleasure.
Thank you. And then in conclusion, we are please join us for our next session, Managing the COVID-19 Crisis in Emergency Room Family Physician's Perspective, with Dr. Robert Dex, the Vice Chair of Department of Emergency Medicine at Ellis Hospital in Schenectady, New York. And again, you can place your questions here or on the message board, and Dr. Botz will answer them when he is able and try his best to answer them. Thank you so much.